am Maria Laura Bancheri. My supervisors are Professor Riccardo Rivon and Dr. Giuseppe Fermetta. And the title of my thesis is A Flexible Approach to the Estimation of Water Budgets and its Connection to the Travel Time Theory. So this is the outline of my presentation. I will give you an introduction about the topic, some preliminary information on informatics and mathematics. I will talk about a semi-distributed model for runoff and evapotranspiration. I will give you just a part of information about the travel time theory, and I will show you an application using the Poisson-Arago River Basin, and I will show you two new components, which are a spatial and spatial interpolation component and the long wave radiation bound component, and then the conclusions. So, as you can see from these slides, there are a lot of keywords that are all in support of a bigger idea, which is geoframe. Geoframe, as we usually define it, is a system for doing hydrology by computer, and based on two principal concepts, which are the open science concept and the reproducibility of research. In fact, one of the main goals of this thesis is to present a new way of thinking and to produce research based on the concept of the reproducibility. We usually report the famous sentence from Professor Jim Kircher, which says, getting the right answers for the right reasons. This sentence is achieved in many notable work, but how many times does a researcher try to reproduce a result shown in a paper that doesn't come out? Or how many times does a researcher try to use a software that doesn't work? Too many. So that's why this sentence, getting the right answers for the right reasons, should be combined with the concept of reproducibility of research, that in this case was applied both regarding the hydrological modeling and the travel time theory. So the starting point of all this project was JGRASS New Age, which is a semi-distributed model that was developed by Dr. Giuseppe Fermetta during his PhD, and was built on top of OMS. OMS, which stands for Object Modeling System, is an environmental modeling framework that helps the modeler with some integrated features, which are calibration tools or data visualization, and helps the model integration through the use of components. And then I will show you what is a component, and then supports the multi-threading and the processes parallelization. So basically, I usually to describe a component as a piece of a puzzle. Actually, it is a self-contained block of code, which is implemented to perform a specific task. So for example, in this case, you can see that we have different components. For example, the kriging component that we use to perform the interpolation of meteorological inputs. And one of the scope of MS is to put these pieces of puzzle in the right places according to the modeler needs. So according to the specification of the modeler, OMS does this. So puts the right pieces in the right places in order to perform a task. So in this case, for example, we have that kriging component to interpolate for the interpolation of meteorological variables, and then the energy balance components, then snow melting, and so on. But the components are pieces of puzzle that can be interchanged, so they are interchangeable. So for example, if you want to use another interpolation, or we want simply add a new component, this is really easy and straightforward, and doesn't require any particular informatics skill from the modeler point of view. So it is simply, we can simply change this component in our big puzzle. According to this concept of the component, JGRASS New Age was developed. So as you can see, there are a lot of components already implemented. There are components for the geomorphological model setup, which allows you to pass from the digital elevation model to obtain a lot of features like, the slope, the HRU partitioning, and so on. There are components for the interpolations of meteorological inputs. There are components for the energy balance, for evapotranspiration, snow melting, and there are also some calibrators that are integrated in the core of the object modeling system. So starting starting from Geographic New Age, we worked toward the reproducibility of the model itself, because we wanted to obtain a fully reproducible research system. But what does it mean? We try to follow these five steps toward the reproducibility of research, which means make our products available on web under an open license, make them available with the good documentation, so we brought the documentation, make available references, figures, and how we made these figures, use a public provider like GitHub or Zenodo in order to store data and codes. And then we have a user group that helps the users and the community. So following these five steps, we passed from what I used to call Geoframe New Age, so it's a new version of New Age, in which you can see that there are some components in red blocks that are the already existing components already implemented in New Age, in which we worked on rewriting the codes in order to exploit all the features of Java program object-oriented programming. We increased the flexibility in implementing some design patterns. We decided to use another built-in system. We use this Travis Continuous Integration, which is a really nice tool which helps the developer to test the components automatically on the web. And then we brought the documentation to obtaining a variety of modeling solutions, so a variety of connections of these pieces of puzzle, the big puzzle. And then we provide all our data, results, simulations, so everything is available. And these are our repository, so we have a repository for all our codes, repository for with the project examples. So we have a community blog, so in which we report our new findings. And this is, for example, an example of a documentation that we wrote. So everything is for the available for the user, for the research, the interested researcher. Hierarchical system, as you know, are nonlinear, complex, open dissipative systems, and they consist of many coupled processes. So the other question was, is it possible to represent these processes in a unique way, which corresponds one-to-one to a set of equations? The answer is, of course, yes. So we start from the BetriNets presented in Murata in 1989, which is a mathematical graphical representation of hydrological models, which represents the hydrological models through these symbols, which are a square for the transitions, a circle for places, and a line for the connections. So for example, transitions are the fluxes. So we know that for example, in these two cases, the fluxes in input are precipitation and in output is discharge. Regarding the places, is where we solve the storage, the water budget. So in this case, we have two ordinary differential equations to solve the water budget. And then we have different kind of connections depending on the fluxes, actually. So for example, we have that precipitation is measured, and we know that because we have a dashed line that is connecting precipitation to the storage. And then we can have, for example, a linear reservoir model or a nonlinear reservoir model that is different, uniquely identified by this small circle. So when a researcher looks at this graph, is immediately knows what is going on, so that he has to solve an equation and what kind of relationship are between the fluxes. But in order to complete this representation, we can add a table of association in which we specify so the expression and the list of symbols. So this is I concluded the first part of the presentation in which I introduce you the OMS and the concept of components. what we did for the improvement and enhancement of JGRASS New Age, the concept of reproducibility of research, and the mathematical graphical representation using open PetriNets. I forgot just something about PetriNets, that the version of Murata was not considering time-varying quantities, but of course we are dealing with time-varying quantities, so we worked with what we call time-continuous PetriNets. So in this line, they reported this famous sentence from Levin 1999, which states that simple models are a good place to start because their transparent features provide clarity and a base for elaboration. But as you can see from this picture in the bottom, there is actually a trade-off between the model complexity, the data availability. That means that not always. A larger model complexity gives a higher predictive performance, as well as if we have a large data set, the model could be unable to exploit all the data. So one of the tasks of the hydrological modeler is to find the balance, a balance between the model complexity and the data availability. And with this same, and starting from the idea that many modern hydrological systems at the catchment scale, the hydrology can be reduced to a set of interconnected reservoirs, we decided to implement a new model for a new semi-distributed model for runoff and evapotranspiration. In literature, there are many notable works that use this approach. But what we wanted was a more flexible approach, which helps us to disentangle all the fluxes, to make room in the partition between evaporation and transpiration that could be put together with the approach of the travel times, always in a balance between the data availability and the model complexity. So we developed this new semi-distributed model that we call the embedded reservoir model, since it is considering connected reservoirs. This is the PetriNets representation, which is, you can see, really nice. And you can immediately see how the components are connected. Each of these pieces is actually a component implemented in JGRASS New Age. And this model considers five different reservoirs, which are the snow. The snow, the canopy, the root zone reservoir, the surface runoff, and the groundwater reservoir. For each, and these connection schema of connection is solved for each HRU in which is our domain is schematized. So going through each of these reservoirs, so we have the snow reservoir. In this case, we are going to solve two ordinary differential equations, one for the ice and the other one for the water. The formulation that we use for the melting discharge from the melting was taken from Regina Hawk 1999. And the inputs in this case are the rainfall and snowfall, while the output is the melting discharge. And then we have some transition between the places. The melting discharge is actually then the input of the canopy. Of course, if there is no snow, there is no melting discharge, so it's just rainfall. And from the canopy, again, we are going to solve an ordinary differential equation in which we know that the input is the rain, while the outputs are the evaporation from the wet canopy, so we are going to consider the layer, the film of water above the canopy, and then we have the true fall. In this case, the model that we consider is a revised form of the Rutter model. Then the true fall that is arriving on the ground arrives to the rooted zone layer, and here is partitioned between the rooted zone and the runoff according to a coefficient alpha that considers the saturation of the root zone layer. So we have that the input in this case is 1 minus alpha times the true fall minus the evapotranspiration from the root zone, while the output is the recharge term to the groundwater. in this case, we see that the output is a nonlinear resolver. In fact, we have a small circle in this case. So alpha times the trueful, so the part that is exceeding the maximum storage in the rooted zone, goes directly into the runoff layer, and is model the discharge at the output from the rooted zone layer is modeled again through a nonlinear reservoir model. And finally, we have the groundwater reservoir, where the input is the recharge term from the rooted zone, and the output is the discharge from the groundwater. The total discharge is going to be the sum of the discharge from the groundwater and discharge from the runoff layer. So this is just an example of the connection that can be done using this model, because as I said, we implemented each of these circles in a different component, but we can have a lot of different other schema. For example, we can use a connection like this or something even complex. And everything is possible just using and connecting the component thanks to OMS, thanks to the flexibility of the model. So in this second part of the work, I presented you the embedded reservoir model, which schematized each HRU with the five coupled storages. And using the patterns, as you see, it was really easy and straightforward to understand what processes were going on. And then I showed you the flexibility of these models because you can obtain an infinite possible modeling solutions. This was actually needed for the core of the thesis, which was the travel time theory, which became a tool to disentangle these complex systems and opened the way to for explicit unification of the geomorphic theories and the storage-based modeling. So in literature, there are many notable work on travel times. And in the last decades, these three notable works from Botter, Benetin, and Arman opened the way to this new approach to the travel time theory. But starting from this approach, we found that something was missing, something was undisclosed, and we tried to repeat from the scratch, reproduce the results that were obtained in these papers, and we understood that we need to formulate a new framework that considers the travel time theory. So first of all, let's start with some definitions. So the travel time is the time that a water particle takes to travel across a catchment. So if we consider our control volume, we can consider the injection time, so the time in which this particle entered in our control volume, and its exit from our control volume. So if we consider a generic time t between the injection and the exit, we can define the residence time as the time between the injection and the generic time t, and the life expectancy as the time between t and its exit. So the travel time is basically the sum of the residence time and the life expectancy. So if we consider our control volume, in this case we consider just the big control volume, we know all this equation, so the solution of the water budget, we can consider that each of these variables, so for example the storage, has the integral of its subvolumes. So given the time we are considering and given the injection time, this integral spans from a time zero that we consider sufficiently back in the past, and the minimum between the time t we are considering and the precipitation time. So each of these variables can be expressed as the integral between zero and t of the subvolumes, so the same for discharge and evapotranspiration, and we can obtain what we call age-ranked water budget, in which each of these variables is expressed as a function of the time t we are considering and the injection time of the particle within the control volume. So again, some definition, what is the backward probability? So if we are in the generic time t, we are looking backward to what happened in our control volume till the injection time, so we are looking past. So, for example, if we have a time series or rainfall inputs like the one shown in the upper part, so we can define the residence time, therefore probability, as the ratio between the subvolume of the storage, so given t, given the injection time, and the total storage, which is its integral, till time t. In the same way, we can define the travel time backward probability, again, which is the ratio between the age rank, the discharge, so given t, given the injection time, and its integral. In the same way, we can define the evapotranspiration backward the PDF. So this is just a small clarification about what we mean with t sufficiently back in the past. So if we, for example, we go one, our system is not stationary, we want to add information from starting from previous time step, we actually want to consider, have to consider the integral starting from minus infinity till time t. And this means that we have to consider an antecedent storage, so an initial condition, which we call the S0. So in this case, the definition of the backward residence time distribution is slightly different because it considers the integral between minus infinity and t, as well as the definition of the mean travel times, which in this case has to consider a backward information. So going back to the initial equation that I showed you, we can express the water, the age rank, the water budget, in which each term is multiplied by the distribution. So we have the residence time distribution, the travel time, and the evapotranspiration times backward distribution, which is conditioned to the time t we are considering, while the precipitation is multiplied by a delta Dirac distribution, since for definition, precipitation has H0. This equation becomes an ordinary differential equation with the only one unknown when we introduce a relation between the backward residence time distribution and the backward travel time distributions. This relation is omega and is defined as a storage selection function, so SIS. What is a storage selection function? It's a function that says how the particles are removed from our control volumes. So for example, we can have a condition of uniform mixing in which all the particles have the same probability to leave our control volume. Or we can have a preference for new water. And so in this case, we know that water that entered the last are the first particles are leaving the first. While a preference for old water means that the particle with a higher age is leaving the volume first. So once we define, I will show you then how this storage selection function, this equation is just a simple ordinary differential equation in which what the unknown is the residence time backward distribution that can be solved from any numerical solver. So once then, we know we solve this equation, we are able to compute the travel time and the evapotranspiration time backward distribution, and then the mean travel times. This formalism can be applied in general to every substance. So for example, let's indicate this generic substance with the superscript E. So again, we have the same equation that I'll show you, in which in this case, for simplicity of notation, we neglected the evapotranspiration, but we can consider the evapotranspiration too. And then solving this equation, we can compute the concentration of the generic substance, since we are interested in this concentration, just knowing the backward travel time distribution and the concentration of the substance in the input. The important thing is that these two equations can be coupled. So we have the water budget and solid transport that can be coupled in order to solve, in order to not assign a priori the shape of the storage selection function, but actually to derive the storage selection function. Forward the probability. In this case, we are are in the injection time, we are looking forward to what is going to happen in our control volume. That's why we actually define not trial time but response time, since it describes how the catchment is going to respond to a rainfall input. In this case, the forward travel time, PDF, is conditional to the injection time, of course, and is defined as the ratio between the age rank to discharge, so given the injection time and given the time, and the input, and this theta. Theta is a partitioning coefficient, is basically the ratio between the volumes on discharge and the sum of volumes of discharge and of the transpiration. And I will show you later with the example of Casina River how this partitioning coefficient is important, how much is important. And then, thanks to the near-miss relationship, we can relate the backward and the forward probability distributions, thanks also to the use of theta. But these equations are just a few equations from this big framework that we developed about travel times that contains several clarification and extensions such as the concept of forward and backward as a conditional PDS, the relations one-to-one with the age rank to quantities, and extensions include the information about partitioning coefficient and the formulation of all the solid transport. As I said, it's just part of a wider theory that is presented in our article. Let's jump to the results. So this is the Casina River Basin. It's a small basin located in the Alpine Veneto region, and is around 112 square kilometers. It was discretized in 42 HRUs using the components that I show you for the geomorphological model setup. The installation for measuring discharges and the buckets for the truffle. So we okay for the truffle. And as I said, each of the 42 HRU was modeled using that schema of connection that I show you using the petrinets. But this is informatic part. So this is the schema of connections that I used for simulate discharge for each HRU. So we simulated the energy balance, the snow processes, the potential evapotranspiration, which are the inputs of the canopy, the surface flow, the rest zone that is connected to the groundwater. So for each HRU we solved all these connections. And then, thanks to an infrastructure that was developed by my colleague Francesco Serafin, we were able to route the discharge modeled for each HRU till the outlet. So in this schema, in this graph, each HRU was considered as a node that was connected, and one of the important features of this graph was that independent nodes were processed in parallel. This means that the computation from the informatic point of view was really performing and fast. So just to give you some numbers, for a simulation of 5 years at hourly time step, it takes like 1 minute for solving all that equation for each of the 42 HRUs. So these are the results in terms of simulated discharge against measured. I performed two applications, one at hourly time step and one at daily time step. Why? Because at hourly time step we have small problems in the measurements that led to small problems in the calibration of the parameters of the model. So in this case, you can see from the index of goodness that are reported there that the index are good, but the index are good. Actually, I performed also a compare with the HIMODE model. So the HIMODE model is the red one, which is a really notable model. model, and the embedded reservoir is the blue one, while the measurements are in black. And we performed the simulation both. We calibrated the parameters at Stancari station, while then we validated the model also at Bazzoni station, which is a hub. Thanks to the flexibility of our modeling solution, it is possible then to understand if we are getting the right answers for the right reason. So if we are modeling the fluxes and the processes in the right way, because we can obtain these nice waterfall charts, which helps us to understand the input, the output, how the storage is changing in time. And so, for example, in this case, we saw that we actually were underestimating the actual level of transpiration, which is still in the range of literature, but it's a little bit low. So it's around 20%, but of course we can validate the model, verifying that, for example, the variation of the storage, the closure of the budget for each year, and so on. And then it was possible to perform the travel time analysis. In this case, we considered the case of uniform mixing. So in this case, the storage selection function were equal to 1. So every particle had the same probability to leave the control volume. And what is interesting in this graph is, of course, the mean travel times in this case was a little bit low, but it depends on the length of our simulation. And this is clear because if we consider the trend line, this trend line is increasing. So with a longer simulation, we probably could have the right travel times for the considered volume. And then that we have the lowest values in the case of the discharge peaks that we saw. And then this is the partitioning coefficient that I told you. This is an important coefficient for the basin, because first of all, you can see that the partitioning coefficient is varying during the year. So this is, for example, these are the coldest months, and this is summer. So we can see that evapotranspiration is increasing and decreasing during the year. And it is interesting also to see that it is oscillating. This means that according to the variability of the evapotranspiration during the day. Since it is an integral, then it tends to a finite value that is actually a value that is proper of the catchment that we are analyzing, and after a precise time that it again is a specific property of the volume of the basin. These are the results for the daily simulation, and in this case we can see that the simulation were better also in the case of the peak. So we had a really good agreement because we overcame the problem with the calibration tool, and thanks to the waterfall charts we also verified that in this case we are in line with the expected evapotranspiration. So we had that the actual evapotranspiration from the canopy increased till the 18%. This is another interesting graph, because the canopy was modeled through the line, the leaf area index that was got from satellite data. And this showed that as the leaf area index increased during summer, we have a decrease of this ratio, which is actually the amount of precipitation that is arriving on the ground. So here we have an increasing of evapotranspiration, so less water that is arriving on the ground. And this is the time series of potential evapotranspiration in red versus the canopy, the actual evapotranspiration from the canopy and from the root zone. Also, in this case, we performed the travel time analysis. Again, we have that the mean travel times was around 77 days, and we have a trend line. This could be an useless result, but actually it is really meaning, because we verified verified that using hourly time step or daily time step, the results of the travel time analysis didn't change. So this means that we can decrease a lot of the computational costs, so using also the daily time scale. And this is why these are the results obtained for the partitioning coefficient. Again, you can see that there is a trend according to the seasonality, but in this case, since we obtained volumes of actual evapotranspiration greater, we have that during summer the value of the partitioning coefficient was lower. Finally, very quickly, these are the two components. So the spatial interpolation component and the long-wave radiation balance component. I am showing you this because these are the statement of GeoFrame. So the components that we developed according to those five steps, according to the reproducibility of research. So in the spatial interpolation component, we implemented 10 theoretical models for the semivariograms, 4 types of kriggings that can be varied at runtime. And this is the application that we performed on Isarco River Basin, while this is the long-wave radiation balance component, in which we test the long-wave radiation using a wide data set. So you can see there are 40 stations in the US, and we implemented 10 different formulations for the clear sky emissivity, and these are the results. So jumping quickly to the conclusions, so one of the aims of this work, as I said, is to present a new way of thinking, develop and produce research, because the reproducibility was our leading principle that during these years. And some of the concepts could be already debated, already solved, it's true. But here I treat it from a new perspective of the open science that it's important. The embedded reservoir model allows to experiment different representation and spatial variability, including multiple option for individual processes, and also separating the informatic part from the numerical part. And moreover, it could be put together with the travel time theory, with the age-ranked approach. Moreover, the PetriNets, so the geographical algebraic notation, helps the researcher and the reader to understand immediately what is going on. Moreover, the thesis presented this new theoretical framework and several clarification and extensions of important concepts, as well as we implemented all the theory in components, so they are can be connected into the hydrological model, so it's really easy to perform the travel time analysis, and important results about the daily time scale and the hourly time scale shown that we can reduce also the computational requirements of the calculation. Of course, further analysis of the travel times are upcoming, considering different mixing, maybe considering the famous isotope data. And finally, a mention is also to be made to the new components, so the kriging and the long-wave radiation balance, which can be considered the state of art of our system toward the reproducible science. So finally, I will really thank my supporters, my friends, my family here in Trento and there in Fort Collins. And I want to really, really thank my supervisor, Riccardo Rigon, most of all, and thank you for your attention.
Grazie di questa presentazione. Io ho qualche piccola curiosità o richiesta di chiarimento.
Okay.
Allora,
vedo una lista lunga.
Sono piccole cose. Partiamo dall'inizio. Nella descrizione, dei diversi moduli. Del modello hai parlato, quindi del reservoir per la snow, per la canopy, per la root zone, per surface runoff e groundwater. Poi hai parlato di rain snow separation. Mi chiedevo se è stato in qualche modo considerato o potrebbe essere considerato uno sviluppo futuro la snow on canopy. Quindi la funzione di storage della neve all'interno della canopy.
In verità, per quanto riguarda la canopy, alla canopy arrivava già la melting discharge, quindi già come input, cioè la neve veniva modellata, quindi prima arriva sulla canopy e poi dalla canopy veniva modellata la tufol. Quindi viene considerata, però ovviamente viene considerata attraverso la formulazione che ho detto di Regina Oak. Quindi sempre come layer, come film sulla canopy.
Mentre lo stem flow non è
No,
considerato.
no, non l'ho considerato. E grazie all'utilizzo dei dati satellitari dell'IFARIA Index, quindi dove c'era canopy, è stata modellata la canopy, dove non c'era la neve, arrivava direttamente sul ground, diciamo.
Va bene, poi un'altra cosa, hai parlato di, hai accennato diciamo al termine di acqua nuova, acqua vecchia, riferendoti poi all'acqua nuova esce dopo e l'acqua vecchia esce prima.
No,
E poi,
sì.
almeno
Sì,
se non ho capito male, ma
sì.
questo mi sembrava di aver sentito, e dopo poi nell'esempio applicativo nel bacino del Posina parli di uniform mixing. E mi sembra che le due cose siano un po' contrastanti, cioè se tu consideri che l'acqua vecchia esce dopo, scusa, esce prima, vuol dire che non stai considerando un mixing, no? Tra le due acque,
Allora,
o mi manca qualche pezzetto.
sì, diciamo che forse mi sono espressa, sicuramente mi sono espressa male, ma le storage selection function sono la parte tricky, diciamo, della formulazione di travel times. E si possono considerare differenti le storage selection function. Una, la più semplice di tutti, è la uniform mixing. Quindi non abbiamo, diciamo, preferenze per acqua vecchia, acqua nuova, tutte le particelle possono abbandonare, hanno la stessa probabilità di abbandonare il volume di controllo nello stesso modo. Quindi noi abbiamo usato il caso più semplice, uniform mixing. Perché abbiamo usato il caso più semplice? Perché come ho fatto vedere, la definizione delle storage selection function avrei potuto considerare anche una storage selection function che considerava appunto l'acqua vecchia o l'acqua nuova, ma i risultati devono essere ovviamente validati con dati di isotopi o accoppiando le due equazioni che ho fatto vedere del trasporto dei soluti e insomma, del water budget, dell'equazione del bilancio di massa, è possibile derivare la storage selection function. Poiché io non ho utilizzato i dati degli isotopi per la validazione, per diciamo, l'utilizzo del trasporto dei soluti, ho considerato il caso del mixing generico. Avrei potuto anche considerare una storage selection function che considerava l'acqua nuova o l'acqua vecchia, però i risultati erano veri tanto quanto quelli del uniform mixing.
Io sto facendo domande in italiano, se va bene. Prima avevamo deciso.
L'italiano benissimo.
E poi hai fatto vedere una simulazione di un caso in cui presentavi anche questo modello high mod, giusto? E dicevi un modello potente. Mi sembrava adesso, senza andare a cercare per un nuovo, però mi sembrava ci fosse un caso, se puoi ritornare magari alla slide, qui c'era un picco che predetto dal modello, eccolo lì, ecco, quello rosso, diciamo, dopo il grosso picco
Sì, insomma,
sì, blu. Non capisco se lì sotto c'è il misurato e quindi l'embedded funziona bene col misurato e soprattutto quel picco, diciamo, rosso dell'high mod che invece mi sembra sovrastimi il misurato.
allora, i gravi problemi che abbiamo avuto per quanto riguarda la modellazione a scala oraria erano proprio derivanti dal fatto delle misure, perché, beh, insomma, bene, c'è la centrale di imbottigliamento più l'hydropower plant che determina quelle oscillazioni. Questo ha determinato non poche difficoltà nella calibrazione dei parametri, perché il calibratore cerca di raggiungere i picchi, come in questo caso, no? Lui cercava di raggiungere questo picco di questa portata, però quando lui poi appunto riesce a riprodurre il picco, poi determina che ci sono tanti altri picchi che nella realtà poi non vengono, non esistono. Quindi c'è un problema proprio qui nella calibrazione, nella modellazione dei parametri, cosa che io invece sono riuscita un po' più a sistemare, perché appunto iMod è un modello super performante, ma implementato in blocco, io input, output, quello che mi veniva fuori era questo. Con il mio modello sono stata io un po' a connettere i pezzettini, a giocare, a girare le cose, in modo che poi alla fine riuscissi a riprodurre bene la risposta del bacino. Problemi invece per quanto riguarda la simulazione di lì non ce ne sono stati, perché appunto lì abbiamo proprio tolto tutte le interferenze che c'erano, e quindi no, i modelli sono subito stati performanti.
E se posso chiedere ancora due piccole curiosità. Allora, hai parlato del parametro S0, no? Quindi le condizioni iniziali di storage. Se, come varia? Come lo definisci questa condizione iniziale? Cioè,
che rende? Questa è stata, non so se avete visto, una delle criticità sollevate dal professore Kirchner. Effettivamente noi quando abbiamo fatto la modellazione, quando abbiamo sviluppato la teoria, non ci siamo preoccupati, diciamo, di questa condizione iniziale, in quanto considerando che il tempo che noi consideriamo zero era appunto sufficientemente indietro nel tempo, e soprattutto per una questione anche di risoluzione dell'equazione della distribuzione backward, tutto ci sembrava coerente. Effettivamente poi l'osservazione di Kirchner ci ha fatto aprire la mente, ma per quanto riguarda la modellazione, quello che ho verificato è che negli istanti iniziali l'integrale del PDF, che in teoria dovrebbe essere 1, che deve essere 1 in realtà, all'inizio era leggermente minore di 1, e questo derivava appunto dal fatto che noi in quel momento stavamo trascurando la condizione antecedente. Quindi di fatto nelle simulazioni che io ho considerato avevo verificato che all'inizio c'era comunque un'informazione che stava arrivando al passato, ma in quel momento non ne ho tenuto conto. Il professore Kirchner ci ha aperto la mente, quindi next step sarà cercare di ovviamente integrare e introdurre anche questa condizione.
Ok, l'ultima cosetta, hai definito i catchments, i bacini, come dissipative systems. Puoi spiegare un po' più?
Eh sì, perché vabbè, se andiamo a considerare tutti i sistemi di equazioni che sono, che tengono in considerazione anche la parte di energia, perché in teoria tutto questo formalismo può essere anche applicato al trasporto di energia, cioè con poche, più o meno, poche modifiche possiamo considerare anche la parte, diciamo, energetica. Quindi cercando di rappresentare nel modo più semplice, ma tenendo appunto in conto la fisica dei sistemi, quindi la parte ideologica, la parte energetica e così via, abbiamo cercato appunto di trovare un modo che fosse abbastanza straightforward attraverso i Petrinets, per invece di rappresentare di schematizzare i bacini con i classici, diciamo, reservoir, che poi a un certo punto tutte le frecce, tutte le cose iniziano a confondersi. Ci sembrava che i Petrinets ci aiutassero in questo senso, per semplificare, insomma, la notazione.
Grazie, ho concluso.
Io ho proprio una curiosità, non altro, sempre a proposito della funzione distribuzione del tempo di residenza, insomma, sostanzialmente quello di cui si è parlato prima. È stata assunta un completo miscolamento, se ho capito bene.
Sì.
Ecco, visto che poi sono stati esaminati gli archi temporali abbastanza lunghi, non si è riscontrata una qualche dipendenza stagionale di questa funzione? Quindi che potesse esserci degli andamenti differenti, appunto, secondo me.
Sì, sì, le storage and action function sono sicuramente dipendenti dal tempo. Infatti l'altra analisi che avrei voluto fare, poi per motivi di tempo non sono riuscita a vedere, era appunto valutare a posteriori come una volta simulati i residence time e i travel times era possibile ricostruire come variava la selection function, sicuramente. Sì.
Col tipo di reservazione box che avete,
sì,
chiaramente
sì.
Ce ne sono alcuni che dimostrano gli andamenti stagionali.
Ma sì, sì, sicuramente, cioè la condizione dell'uniform mixing è quella più semplice e semplificata che si possa assumere, ma ovviamente è necessario considerare una storage selection function che sia physically based.
No, no, certo.
Sì.
Anche io solamente delle curiosità un po' da non idrologo naturalmente. nel bacino sperimentale, questo qua del Poggin, avete misurato le portate ovviamente in uscita e le precipitazioni. Come si fa quindi a determinare il peso relativo poi delle diverse componenti, cioè quello che poi viene assorbito nel terreno come groundwater piuttosto che quello che dal cano che arriva al terreno? Come viene effettuato la valutazione dei pesi relativi in modo tale poi da fare la calibrazione che poi dà dei risultati che poi sono oggettivamente molto buoni?
Allora, per quanto riguarda le misure, noi appunto, come lei diceva, avevamo precipitazione e temperatura, e grazie alla connessione, allo schema di connessione dei componenti che vi ho fatto vedere prima, noi che cosa abbiamo fatto? Abbiamo sfruttato sostanzialmente le misure che avevamo a disposizione, e attraverso la connessione di tutti questi componenti, quindi input, output, fino alla sezione di chiusura, abbiamo fatto la calibrazione di tutti i parametri sulle portate. Quindi considerando anche i processi di neve, quindi lo scioglimento, il melting, e praticamente calibrando i parametri sulle portate, poi automaticamente tutti i vari processi sono stati simulati. Quindi è una calibrazione a valle. Ovvio è che se avessimo avuto le misure di neve, quindi per esempio dello snow water equivalent, avremmo potuto calibrare i parametri qui.
Certo.
Quindi mettere la calibrazione sulla neve e poi andare a cascata.
Okay, quindi sono fatto solamente diciamo sulla portata.
Sì, sulle portate, okay. sì.
E tornando alla questione della condizione iniziale, in questo caso che condizione, forse me lo sono perso, ma che condizione, come è stata determinata la condizione iniziale?
Ecco, in questo caso, come dicevo, non l'abbiamo considerata.
Ok, va bene. Ecco, secondo te qual è l'influenza adesso, al di là di quelle che sono le critiche che sono state fatte, ma non lo sai, nel senso che.
No, sicuramente è una condizione che dobbiamo considerare. Cioè, nel senso che, appunto, come dicevo, nelle simulazioni io mi sono resa conto che, essendo che l'integrale della PDF nella prima parte, certo, della serie temporale non integrava 1, questo significava,
no, vale,
appunto, che doveva esserci imposta condizione iniziale. Questo sicuramente avrà dei risultati anche in termini dei tempi medi di residenza, perché essendo che...
Ma nella fase iniziale, diciamo.
Esatto, nella fase iniziale. Cioè, a medio tempi di residenza così in bassi, potevano essere, cioè il nostro approccio,
certo,
può essere corretto su lunghe serie temporali. Cioè, se io avessi fatto una simulazione di 10-20 anni, la condizione iniziale ovviamente sarebbe persa,
certo,
e quindi noi in questo senso non ci eravamo preoccupati della condizione iniziale, ovviamente su simulazioni brevi.
Ciao.
Sì,
questa
sì,
anche.
Finisce?
ovviamente volevo ringraziare il professore Borga, la dottoressa Giulia Zuecco e il professore Penna per avermi dato i dati per il bacino del Posi, della Trufol, e per la modellazione del Posi.
Bene, va bene.